So if you will look with me now in Acts chapter 1, this is the word of God. God's word is the truth. Look down with me to verse 6. So when they, that is the disciples, had come together, they asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? And he said to them, it is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven, as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus, who was taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. And when they had entered, they went up to the upper room where they were staying, Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus and Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James. All these with one accord were devoting themselves to prayer, together with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. In those days, Peter stood up among the brothers. The company of persons was in all about 120. And then he said, The grass withers and the flower fades. The word of our God abides forever. By his grace and mercy, may his word be preached for you. Please be seated. We're going to jump into this, and I'm going to be try to be timely with you in this the time that we have in this service together and looking at God's word in this second great revival that we've studied. Now, I want to give you three questions that I would like to have in your mind as we come to this study of the second great Jerusalem revival. Now, by the way, there have been a number of revivals, but the Bible takes time to highlight two of them. One that we looked at last week in Nehemiah chapter 8 and 9. One that we're looking at this week in Acts chapter 1. Hundreds of years later, Acts chapter 1 and 2. But I do want to remind you that we have had three texts that are crucial. Now, what we're doing is we're taking a look at this issue of revival. Why? Well, let me give you one reason. Here's a reason. We are praying that God will not only send the gospel to the nations, but he will bring it in a fresh way to our nation, that we might see a gospel awakening, or to put it in the words of Jesus in Matthew chapter 9, that we would see a gospel harvest, that he would harvest thousands into the kingdom of God through the gospel. But when Jesus does a gospel awakening in a nation, he does it through his church, a gospel, healthy, alive church. That's why we're asking God for revival. We have a church today in our country that's 5 miles wide, 1 inch deep, spiritually impotent, biblically illiterate. Now, we've got a lot of things going on, and in some places there seem to be amazing statistics, but the reality is influence and power is not there. Now, if there is to be a gospel awakening, then we need a gospel harvest, then we need gospel revival in the church of Jesus Christ. Now, here's a question. Are we reasonably assured that revival brings gospel harvest? Now, my premise has been, and I've tried to support it biblically, and I've tried to support it in the church history, that gospel awakenings come from revivals in the church, and that revivals in the church issue forth in gospel awakening. Is there warrant to believe that? There's a question I want you to put in your mind. Is there warrant to believe that you can't have a gospel awakening without a gospel revival in the church? A gospel awakening in a nation without a gospel revival in the church? And is there warrant to believe that a gospel revival in the church will lead to a gospel harvest, a gospel awakening? The texts that we've tried to use are three key texts that we started in January with our theme, Revive Us Again. The key text number one was Psalm 85:6. Psalm 85:6, Revive Us Again, O Lord. Now, when you see that word again, what does that tell you? That means the church and God's people need revival more than once. That means that they need revival time and time again. What does that tell you? That tells you that God's people have a penchant for fickleness and faithlessness. But we have a God who is faithful. Revive us. Again, what does that tell you? That means he's revived before. That means he not only revived us, converted us, he's revived us. When we have buried ourselves in the distractions of embedded sin, or we have removed our focus from the Lord and something else, that God comes back when we have buried ourselves in the death of distraction or embedded sin or entangling sin, and God brings a revival to bring dead churches back to life again and again and again. He is gracious to his covenant people. The second text that we looked at was a key text, and that's how does God design revival? And we looked at the unassailable text, the unimpeachable text on this. It's 2 Chronicles 7:14, where God says, if my people called by my name, so he's looking at his covenant people. You found them in Israel in the Old Testament. You now find them from all the nations in his church in the New Testament. If my people, my covenant people who are called by my name, and then he gives four clear statements in his design. If my people called by my name, one, humble themselves, two, pray, three, seek my face, four, repent, turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear, and the blessings from heaven flow, and I will make them not marginalized, I will make them my instruments in the land for my glory. By my grace. Those are the four things. And then also, we then went to that great text of Ezekiel 37, in which the whole picture of revival is given for us in a valley of bones. And there were five things that we downloaded from that about when God delivers revival. When God delivers revival, what happens? Well, revival, here's what's clear. Revival is not man's work, it's God's work. And only God can bring it and send it. Secondly, we learned that when God brings and sends revival, he first raises up revival leaders. The third thing we learned is that when God does revival and brings and sends it through revival leaders, he always does it by his Spirit and with his Word. The inseparable interdependent relationship of the Spirit of God and the Word of God. And when he brings it, the fourth thing we learned is that revival that God brings or sends is not for the purpose of a revival experience. Oh, I just want to feel revival. No, no, no. Revival is never the destination. Revival is never the objective. Revival is the corrective that God's people are now able to achieve his objectives. And fifthly and finally, only God can bring revival, because revival is when God brings life from death. And only God can make bones live. Only God can bring life from death. Now, what I've done is I have put those three key texts and the things we distilled from it on the back of your note sheet, and I propose to leave them there for you. But this morning, I have a second question for you. My first question was this. What does a gospel harvest, issue from revival, and does revival issue in a gospel harvest? My second question was this. My second question is, will the revivals we're studying, now we've studied one revival. I have proposed over the next weeks to lay out for you a study of 10 revivals. There are 28, I've counted 28 revivals. That probably is not enough. There's probably more, but I've counted 28 revivals in the scripture. I have selected 10 of them for us to examine. And what I want you to constantly be asking yourself every time we look at one of those, do they match Psalm 85:6? Do they match 2 Chronicles 7:14? Do they match the valley of dry bones? In other words, is our definition of revival hold up every time we look at revival? Does God's design for revival hold up every time we look at one of these revival? Does God's means of delivering it hold up every time we look at these revivals? See, God's word is never contradictory. If we are on track with what God teaches about revival, then these revivals ought to match up with what the Bible, what the scriptures say and what they have declared. So we've had a good definition. Let me remind you of the definition that we had. The definition is this, is that revival is an extraordinary work of God's grace. It is extraordinary. It is a powerful movement of the grace of God, but it takes place through ordinary people. It takes place in ordinary places. It takes place by ordinary means, preaching, prayer, fellowship, witnessing, all of those things that God uses. He uses the ordinary means, ordinary people, ordinary places to do this extraordinary work of grace for an extraordinary purpose, that God's people are raised up for the purposes and alive, and His life, His presence, and His power is with them. And in our first study of the revival, in the first revival in Jerusalem, we noted a foundational evidence whenever there's an authentic revival, a God-sent revival. What is that authentic evidence? Whenever God brings revival, there will always be the label of authenticity, because a God-sent revival always evidences itself with God-centered worship. He brings it through worship. He motivates worship, not just any worship, not the worship of worship, not the worship of worship experiences, but the worship of God. That God Himself is exalted, that in the gathered worship of His people, God is the audience of one, and that we are the ones before Him. And when we leave, it's not how did the worship service do, how did others do, it's how did we do. For we were doing the one thing He says He seeks, true worshipers, in spirit and in truth. Whenever God brings life, true revival is brought in and through and establishes God-centered worship. And God is enthroned in the praises of His people, and God inhabits the praises of His people. Well, now we fast forward hundreds of years later. I mean, stop and think about this as we're going through our Holy Week. We're celebrating the triumphal entry. Hundreds of years after the Nehemiah revival, we now are back in Jerusalem. And we're coming in on this Sunday, this first day of the week. And Jesus is coming in. And when He walks in, He comes in with this throng and the children and the palms and Hosanna to the King. He walks in, He looks into the temple, and He then declares again the prophecy that He will die and be raised again. And then after He looks in the temple, He'll turn and go back to Bethany. That's what will happen on this first day. But that first day is going to be followed by another day and another day and another day. And then you're going to get to the Passover day. We call it Good Friday, when the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world, our Passover Lamb, will do His work. And 50 days after Good Friday is a revival in Jerusalem, Pentecost. 50 days later, there will be a revival that God will send, and from that revival will come a gospel harvest as 3,000 plus are brought into the kingdom. Now, what is happening in this revival? What is taking place? I want you to take your Bibles and look at the revival and the gospel awakening or the gospel harvest. Just a few brief points. I've only got a few moments to do this with you. So take a look at that first verse I read. So when they had come together. Now, that is a verb, but it plays off of a noun that we use for the church. There are two words in the Bible for church. There is the word kirk, and there is the word ecclesia. Now, kirk is only used three times as far as I could find, but ecclesia is the number one, and ecclesia means the called together ones. Here we've got a verb form of it. They had come together. This is the New Testament church, post-resurrection, pre-ascension church. We know they have had four come together meetings, four church meetings. They've gone to church four times, and the place wasn't the church. It was the assembly that was the church. and they had come together. The first time was on the day of the resurrection when Jesus met them in the upper room. Now, there weren't many of them there, but some of them were there, and he met them in the upper room. Jesus met when they came together in the upper room. Now, not everybody was there, like Thomas. Thomas didn't make that Sunday evening worship service. So they had a second worship service. That second worship service was 1 week later in that upper room. And now there were more of the disciples that were there along with some others. Then he had a third meeting, and that was up in Galilee. He met with them up by the Sea of Galilee. And by the way, that one, it looks like, had some other people around, because Paul indicates that there was a time up in Galilee when 500 saw the risen Savior. But we know that he met with them, and he restored Peter there when Peter was given the fish and the three opportunities to reaffirm Christ, having denied him three times, and then instructed, "Take care of my sheep." Well, now we've got the fourth recorded church meeting of the post-resurrection, pre-ascension of Jesus. It's at the Mount of Olives, and Jesus is ascending. And as he is ascending, they say, "When are you going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" And he says, "Well, it's not for you to know the times and say, here's what you do. I want you to go back to Jerusalem, and I want you to pray, and I want you to wait and pray. I'm going to take the gospel through you to all the nations, but don't run out there to the nations. You run to me. You run to me because I'm coming to you. And you go back there and you pray. And not if, notice what he says, the promise of the Father. And when God promises something, he secures it. When the Holy Spirit comes upon you, not if, when he comes upon you, you will receive power, and you will be my witnesses." You want to know when the Holy Spirit comes? Here's when you know when the Holy Spirit comes. People don't talk a lot about the Holy Spirit. They talk all the time about Jesus, because that's what the Holy Spirit comes for them to do. When you receive power, you got power, and then you've got a preoccupation, and that preoccupation is to be my witnesses. That's what you will do when I come there to meet you in the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. And then you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem. And then this gospel earthquake, this epicenter earthquake of the gospel, will go to Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost part of the world. And the book of Acts will record they turned the world upside down. But it starts right here. It didn't start from them leaving the Mount of Olives and getting an organization and a program to get to the nations. It meant when they left the Mount of Olives, the worship service was not over. They had come together there, and when Jesus ascended, the worship service didn't end, but the location ended. They left the Mount of Olives and went back to the upper room. And when they got in the upper room, they were together, and they began to pray. They were in one accord. Now, that doesn't mean they bought a Honda, all right? Yeah, that's not what that means. That means that they were together. They didn't go and say, they're still worshiping the Lord. They're calling upon the Lord. They didn't divide up and say, "Well, I tell you, the fishermen are going to have their worship service and the tax collectors are going to have their worship." No. They're one together. Their unity is not about them and their diversity. Their unity is about the Lord. That's why they could enjoy their diversity. And then as they've come together to pray with one heart, one mind, and one soul praising the Lord, Peter says, "We got a leadership problem here. We got one that's faltered." Now, by the way, we all faltered. And by the way, I denied, but God's restored me. Judas hasn't been restored. He has died, and they record his death and the occasion of it and the details of it in Acts chapter 1. And they said, "But now the Bible says we've got to replace him." So they reached in to replace him. And as they reached in, likely they moved from the 12 to the 70. And in the 70, they found one named Matthias. Now, that's a good name. For those of you visiting, that's my grandson, all right? He wasn't my grandson, but maybe my grandson will be like this, Matthias. And they reach in for Matthias, and they bring him, and he's now numbered with the 12. And then you'll notice that now, wait just a minute, it's not just a few disciples that have returned from their fear and they're fleeing. It's not just a few more, and it's not just those restored like Peter. Now there's 120. So you've got not only the 12 now restored, 11 back to 12, but you've got probably most of the 70. And then it says the women. Now, there were probably two categories of women. One were the women disciples that had surrounded Jesus to support him, like Joanna and Salome and Mary Magdalene and others. But likely also, these would include maybe the wives of some of the disciples. But the women are identified as there along with the others. Not a separate category. They're right there together with them. And then another group has joined the 120. Some unbelievers, his brothers, who did not believe in him. But now they believe in him. You want to know if there's a resurrection? Some brothers got converted after this. And so now they're there along with his mother Mary. So now you've got about 120. So there's the church of 120. Well, I got news for you. This church of 120 is about to get revived. And when it gets revived in one day, they're going to go to over 3,000. And by the way, that's probably just counting the men. So you probably got 7,000 to 9,000. So here this church is just going to take off in an amazing way that is going to be unbelievable out of the revival that takes place. Let me just read a couple of things that happen. Go with me to chapter 2, verse 1. And when the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place, and suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting, and divided tongues as of fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And at this sound, the multitude came together. They were bewildered because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. And they were amazed and astonished. And are not all these speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each one in his own native language, Parthians and Medes and Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabians. We hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God. And all were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, what does this mean? But some others began to mock, saying, oh, they're just filled with new wine. Well, I got news for you. You can go get filled up with new wine and get drunk with new wine. You're not going to pass a foreign language test. So this was not a very good rationalization, but they felt they had to go rationalize it, and that's what they did. So that's what's taking place, is that the reviving work of the Holy Spirit comes. And as the reviving work of the Holy Spirit comes, then he marks out his presence. He is fulfilling the prophecy of Joel 2:11 that the nascent newness of the New Testament church is being established with the presence and power of the living God through the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. And whenever God does something gloriously in the work of redemption, he marks it out many times with the miraculous. And the Bible uses the phrase signs, wonders, and miracles. Work it backwards. Miracles create wonder. Did you see? They were amazed. Miracles create wonders for a sign. God's trying to say something. We all get fascinated with this miracle. We're supposed to be fascinated with what it signifies. And so here is a miracle. In fact, there's three miracles. One is when the Holy Spirit comes, he comes like the sound of a mighty rushing wind. Now, that is not telling you that a hurricane and tornado came to Jerusalem that day. It's like a mighty rushing wind. It doesn't say a mighty rushing wind came in. It sounded, the presence of the Holy Spirit coming with power sounded like a mighty rushing wind. Secondly, second miracle is appearing to each of them, affirming that each one is receiving the Holy Spirit, is the appearance of a tongue of fire, divided, cloven, a cloven tongue of fire appearing as an appearance in front of each one. And then the third miracle, they begin to speak a language they didn't know. But other people knew it. Do we not hear them speaking in our own language? This isn't gibberish. This isn't a download of pagan tongue speaking that would be prevalent throughout the, particularly the among the Greeks. This is a language that the people speaking don't know. It's an unknown to them, but it's known to somebody else. Because they say, look, we hear him speaking in our own language. And these are Galileans. But each one of them is speaking what Peter's preaching. They're speaking in our language, and we can hear them. How did that happen? Some people, oh, I know what it was. They got drunk this morning. And that's all of a sudden gave them the ability to speak in another language. Listen, please don't think you can pass the Spanish test by getting drunk the night before. That's just not going to do it. In fact, don't get drunk, period. But I'm telling you, don't even think it's going to get you past a test. That's not going to happen. This is obviously unbelief will find any way to deny the work of God. Unbelief will find any way, even irrationality, to deny the presence and power of God. But then God moves. And go slip over to verse 37 with me. Just one final text to read. Verse 37. Now when they heard this, that's Peter's preaching, they were cut to the heart. By the way, the Greek word there in the verb is stabbed. It's really a tough word to translate. It means to stab something. They were stabbed in their heart. And they said to Peter, that's conviction. And they said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brethren, what shall we do? And Peter said to them, repent, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. You will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, for the promise, that is, this Holy Spirit, is for you and for your children and for all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself. With many other words, he bore witness and continued to exhort them, saying, save yourself from this crooked generation. So those who had received his word were baptized. How'd they receive his word? Because the Spirit of God gave them reception. They weren't rationalizing they must be drunk with wine. They were receiving the word. By the power of the Spirit of God, the word of God was doing its work. And there were added about 3,000 souls. Again, in just a few chapters, another gospel harvest is going to take place, 5,000. And it says that's just the men. So I think they're using the Hebrew method of counting, which is just the men. So I think this is actually somewhere around 6,000 to 9,000. But it's thousands. Thousands are being ushered into the kingdom of God. There's a gospel harvest that's going on through this church. It's been revived in the upper room. And when the Holy Spirit came and he showed up with signs, wonders, and miracles, God used that because the people heard the sound. They heard the sound, and then they wanted to know what was going on. And then Peter stands up and preaches, and as Peter stands up and preaches, each one of the 120 start also sharing the truth of the gospel in a language they don't know, that the Spirit of God gave them the ability to do it. And then now of that, the Spirit of God began to move upon 3,000 plus, and they are brought into the kingdom of God. And the result of that is now not simply a church that has been established with some fearful disciples, and then a few more, and then the brothers of Jesus, and then 120. Now an epicenter church has been planted in Jerusalem that will go to Judea and Samaria and the world and turn it upside down in less than 25 years, all the way to other continents, because they first didn't go to the world. They first went to God. They first went to him who would bring power and would enable them and equip them. And then from there, they won their Jerusalem, their Judea and Samaria and the uttermost part of the world. So let me give you the takeaway and we'll close in prayer. The takeaway is this: God sent revivals lead to gospel harvests. Here's a revival of 120. Here's a gospel harvest of thousands. God sent revivals lead to gospel harvests secured by God the Father through God the Son, by the power and the presence and authority of God the Holy Spirit. Okay, I want you to do something. I meant to tell you to do this earlier. I forgot to do it. I'm sorry. So would you pretend we're back at the introduction? Good news. I'm not going to go through the whole thing again. But would you be back at the introduction? I have a question I wanted you to answer. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 9, the Bible says, pray to the Lord of the harvest that he will send out workers. Who is the Lord of the harvest? Don't answer out loud, please. Who? I mean, we say it all the time, don't we? Let's pray to the Lord of the harvest. Well, who is he? Who is the Lord of the harvest? Now, we know what he does. He sends out workers into the harvest. Now, the harvest, he doesn't secure it. He just harvests it through the workers he sends out. So, brothers and sisters, let me just take these minutes just to maybe finish this way. The first thing is this. Remember the question I did ask you? Does this revival match Psalm 85:6, our definition of revival? Is this an extraordinary work of God's grace, this revival, the church at Jerusalem? Hello? Yes, let's pretend like we're not Presbyterians. Answer, okay? Is this an extraordinary work of God's grace? Is it using ordinary people? Is it using ordinary means, preaching, prayer, sharing, fellowship? Is it, now you're getting a little weak on me now, all right? Is it in an ordinary place? I mean, upper room? We don't even know where it is now. Upper room, ordinary people, ordinary means, extraordinary work. Is there an extraordinary purpose? I'll tell you what, there's a thousands and thousands of member church being established that God's going to use as a gospel earthquake to change the whole world. And in it, they're going to continually devote themselves to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, to the breaking of bread. There will be great signs and wonders done in the midst of them. They will sell their property, giving to one another, sacrificial giving, loving one another, opening up their homes, sending out the gospel. And day by day, the Lord is adding to their number. That's how it's explained at the end of Acts chapter 2. Is there an extraordinary consequence of this extraordinary work through ordinary people, ordinary means, and ordinary places? This revival matches. So let me ask you a question. Did they follow God's design? Did they humble themselves? Now, they didn't just say, okay, we're going to go take the gospel to the world. No, they went to Jesus. They went to meet God in the upper room. They humbled themselves. They didn't say, okay, evangelistic services held in Athens next week. No, they went to the upper room to receive power in the presence of the Holy Spirit. They humbled themselves. Did they pray together in unity? Did they seek the face of God? Did they turn from their sins? How about Peter, a traitor, now a leader? Did they turn from their sins that had denied him and abandoned him? Now they're willing to stand out to the very same people 2 months later who could put them to death also, and they stand courageously. Some turning has happened here. Well, let me ask you another question. Is this a God-sent revival or a man-manipulated revival? I mean, is this a Valley of Bones experience? Is this a God-sent revival that only God can bring? Is this only explained if God's not here, this doesn't happen? If here is, did God raise up revival leaders for this revival? Did God use his word and his spirit in this revival, the preaching of the word and the coming of the Spirit of God in this revival? Did God bring the revival for the revival experience or for the revival purpose of a church alive, winning Jerusalem and then to Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost part of the world? The purpose of this was not to go around, oh my goodness, could we have another mighty rushing wind? Could we have another language experience? Could we have another cloven tongue experience? Those were signs, wonders, and miracles. What they wanted was what it signified, the presence and power of the living God. That's what they wanted. It was there for that purpose. It wasn't for the revival experience, but the revival objective of being there. And is this God bringing death from life? You better believe it's God bringing death from life. Here are people that would willingly had walked away from the Lord without the Spirit of God, who made them into the great church of Jerusalem in the hands of the living God. And here are 3,000 people that are dead in their sins, and God brings them to life in Jesus Christ. This is the valley. This is 2 Chronicles 7:14. This is Psalm 85:6. And this also matches up with the first revival. God-centered worship is taking place. They're praising God in the temple and everywhere they're meeting, upper room or temple or anywhere. But now another evidence is added. When they've gathered, God-centered worship, and then they scattered with a Christ-exalting witness. And not only Peter, there's evangelistic preaching. Peter stands up and preaches the gospel to those that could put him to death as they did Jesus a little bit, 2 months earlier, 50 days earlier. But not just him, they're doing it too. Listen, when it says you're hearing your young men prophesying, well, you can't say you're hearing young men prophesying if these people aren't prophesying. They're out there sharing the gospel too. Not just Peter, they're sharing the gospel. Why would these people say, do we not hear them speaking in our own language if they're not speaking? In other words, it's not just Peter preaching, they're all sharing the gospel. Personal evangelism is what we call it. So you not only have the church gathered worshiping, you have the church scattered witnessing. That it is bearing witness of Jesus Christ, and then the Lord uses it. And why is all this happening? Because the Spirit of God is there. Who is the Lord of the harvest? The Holy Spirit. That's why at Antioch, Saul and Barnabas are going to be sent out. By whom? The Holy Spirit said, set apart. Who is the Lord of the harvest that sends out the workers? The Father has authored the harvest. The Son has purchased and secured the harvest. And I lose not one. The Holy Spirit executes the harvesting. He sends us out with power. And then he goes ahead of us. Because you know what people are going to do when you show up with Jesus? They're going to rationalize, that's not true, unless the Holy Spirit goes ahead. Here are people that will come up with something as inane, irrational, and honestly just I want to be gracious here, but it's just stupid. This is new wine early in the morning. That's how they're able to speak coherently a language that they've never learned. That makes no sense. But the unbelieving heart will do anything it can to explain away the glory and majesty of God, unless God himself comes and gives a heart ready to receive. 3,000 people showed up there that day, and they had no idea that the Holy Spirit was not only going to send out harvesters, was going to make them a harvest by giving them eyes to see and ears to hear. That's who's doing it, is the Spirit of God. That's why we see him in all of his glory. So, my brothers and sisters, I'm asking you, right now, here's the way most of us think, and I confess me. Now, maybe you're not here. I have always thought of the Holy Spirit. He's personal, and he brings power, and he's present with me, so that I've got the power to be his witness for Jesus, and that's true. But I'm asking you to go a step further. Here's where I'm asking you to see, is the Holy Spirit is with you not simply to give you the power to share the gospel with people. The Holy Spirit has come to you, not for you to use him so much as for him to use you. He's sending you. Pray to the Lord of the harvest who sends out. The Holy Spirit comes to us not so much to be used by us, but for us to be used by him. use me, Holy Spirit, Lord of the harvest. Send me with power, but send me. Let's pray. You'll notice this emphasis on young men and women. Students, I cannot tell you how much I love you. I'm going to be meeting with high school students in just a few moments. I love what God is doing in the lives of our young men and women. Listen, you're going to hear me say it again, but just listen as you pray. God loves to do revivals that lead to great awakenings, gospel harvest, and He loves to use students. He used them in Geneva and Wittenberg for a reformation. Their names were Calvin and Luther. He used them at Oxford for a great awakening. Their names were Wesley and Whitfield. He used them at Yale for a second great awakening and other colleges. He'll use you. Your young men and women shall prophesy. Speak the truth. Lead us. You got some fathers and mothers here that want to go with you. Some of you came here today, and every time you've heard the claim of Jesus, you've reached for one of the rationalizations. But today the Holy Spirit not only sent the gospel to you, but sent to you eyes to see and ears to hear. And you want to come to this Jesus who came on a donkey on that Sunday because He came not to bring judgment, but to bear your judgment at the cross. And now you want to come to Him. There'll be some folks to my left that you can pray with after the service. If you would like to, we would love for this to be the first day of your forever life and to pray with you. Father, thank you for our moments together. We rejoice. Our Lord is King, and He has sent the Lord of the harvest. And the Lord of the harvest sends us in your authority to the harvest that is white. God, continue to empower us. Revive us again. In Jesus' name, amen.